Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 126, All the King's Men. As you know, when Diocletian came to power in 284, he inherited an empire that had spent the better part of 50 years getting kicked around the neighborhood. Everywhere he looked, things were in shambles. He wanted to revive and restore the empire he had been taught to revere, and as he took over, he faced no greater roadblock to this goal than the problem of the malfunctioning governmental apparatus he now headed. What had happened was that as the military crisis became worse and worse, the government had basically become nothing more than the supply arm of the army. If civilians entered into the government's calculations at all, it was only to determine what they might have that the army might need. Everything else, by the dire necessities of the times, was considered an unimportant distraction. But now that the crisis had subsided, it became clear what sorts of really important things had been deemed unimportant distractions. For example, a functioning judicial system. Basically, everything that you would expect a government to do, the imperial government had ceased to do. It was time, then, to reinvent that government. As we've seen, this reinvention started at the very top with the establishment of co-emperors and then the Tetrarchy, but it would descend all the way down to the localest of local levels, as Diocletian ensured that wherever there were Romans, the Roman government would be there. The big problem, really, was that too much was getting missed. There are multiple reasons for the fracturing of imperial authority, and the military and political rationales cannot be understated. But on an administrative level, the establishment of the Tetrarchy was an extension of Diocletian's desire to get more people focused on fewer things so that all that stuff that was getting missed would stop getting missed. Had he done nothing else, the simple fact that there were now four emperors spread out across the empire instead of just one meant that already four times as much work was getting done. Four times as many letters were being answered, four times as many petitions were being ruled on, four times as many decisions were being made. And as a bonus, each tetrarch didn't have to worry about what was going on the other side of the empire, leaving him to focus on the management of his particular domain. Which was nice, because even though it was just a quarter of the empire, those domains were still a pretty huge chunk of land, and millions of people still lived in them. But of course, the division of imperial authority was not the end of Diocletian's reforms. It was just the beginning. In keeping with the theme of getting more people doing fewer things, Diocletian also set about dividing up the empire into smaller, more manageable provinces. Last week, I focused on the military implications of this reformation, so this week, I want to focus on the administrative aspects. There were basically three main things here that were of concern: the collection of taxes, the administration of justice, and the maintenance of the infrastructure. All three of these core missions had been more or less abandoned as the crisis years wore on, and even before then, the size of an individual province, which was big, and the size of a provincial government, which was small, conspired to make most administrations woefully inadequate with regards to all three anyway. Sure, taxes were collected and justice was administered, and the roads were maintained, but not without delays, inefficiencies, and outright failures. When it came to government, Diocletian didn't want to just set things back to the way they had been. He wanted to make the whole operation better. When Diocletian finished drawing his lines all over the map, and I have posted a map of Diocletian's new provincial alignment at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com, the Romans found that their empire now contained over 100 provinces. As with the larger division of the Tetrarchy, the proliferation of new provinces meant that, simply put, governors had less to worry about. And it was a good thing that they had less to worry about, because Diocletian was going to expect more of them than any previous emperor had. For example, he sent out instructions that he expected his governors to be active participants in the judicial system. They were not to ignore petitions or appeals, and they were not to hand them off to subordinates. They had been made the supreme legal authority in their province, and they were damn well going to act like it. It used to be easy to shirk these responsibilities because the absolute flood of plaintiffs and defendants who would come calling made for an easy excuse, but even the most conscientious governor had no hope of dealing with it all himself. So, smaller provinces, and voila, a reasonably sized caseload. I don't want to belabor these points because I think you get the general idea, but suffice it to say that smaller provinces also meant that it was easier to track down tax evaders, and it was easier to notice when a dilapidated building needed to be repaired. More people focused on fewer things meant that fewer things were getting missed. But of course, with all these little provinces running around, coordinating empire-wide initiatives became a major headache. So over and above the provincial governors, Diocletian created a whole new bureaucratic level to help manage macro policy. And these were called the dioceses. The 100-odd provinces were collected into just 12 of these new dioceses, and it was at this level that the most basic policies of the Tetrarchy were implemented. A diocese could be made up by as few as 4 provinces, as in the case of Britain, and as many as 16, as in the case of the so-called Diocese of the East, which encompassed the whole of the Eastern Mediterranean. Their main function was to help enforce policy that was being handed down by the emperor and help oversee policy that was being enacted on the local level. The men in charge of a diocese were called vicars, and they were officially listed as the personal representative of the Praetorian prefect, meaning that they were just about as close to the emperor as you could get these days, which helped streamline the process of rolling out new policies. These novel new super-districts were kept around in the east until Justinian decided to abolish them and go back to the more powerful provincial governor model. But in the west, the dioceses were taken over by the clergy and formed the basis, even today, of Catholic administration in Europe. On the subject of macro policy, I want to insert a small correction for something I said last week with regard to the new military duxes. I said that given the smaller sizes of Diocletian's provinces, that the duxes only commanded small contingents of soldiers, but the opposite was actually true. A dux functioned more like a theater commander, who often oversaw multiple provinces' worth of soldiers in order to maintain strategic coordination out on the frontiers. Their ability to revolt was blunted not so much by the fact that they only commanded a small number of troops, some duxes actually controlled 20,000 men or more, but rather by the fact that they had no political powers and no private control over the tax and levy system that they would need if they were going to fund and feed a revolt. So I apologize for having denigrated the rank and dignity of the noble dux. The point of adding new layers of administration was to try to get everyone on the same page. Diocletian wanted the empire to function as one coordinated mechanism, with all parts working in concert with one another for the betterment of the whole. To this end, he also initiated 2 highly unpopular shifts, at least in the affected regions, to make sure that no part of the empire thought it was somehow better or different than the rest. I am speaking, of course, of his treatment of 2 parts of the empire that most definitely considered themselves better and different, Italy and Egypt. As he was splitting up the provinces and appointing vicars, Diocletian decided that the time for special treatment was over, and that henceforth everyone would be equal within what had become in every single way a multinational empire. The Italians, going back to the very beginning of Rome's expansion, had been exempt from taxation and had always enjoyed certain other little perks that came with being the home base of the empire. But now, that was over. Divided into 16 districts and watched over by a vicar, Italy was now treated just like any other province. Only the city of Rome itself maintained its exemption, one of the few deferential nods Diocletian ever made to the birthplace of his empire. Egypt, on the other hand, had always paid its taxes. though there was an awful lot of dodging going on. But they had also been granted a degree of autonomy. They were allowed to keep their own records, they ran off their own calendar, and perhaps most importantly, they coined their own money at a mint in Alexandria. All of this, too, was canceled by Diocletian as he implemented his nice, clean, rational order, free of exemptions, exceptions, preferential treatment, and special deals. Maybe the empire could afford such things in good times, but the good times were long gone. It was time for everyone to pitch in equally. For the senatorial aristocracy in Italy, the blows to their status were now coming fast and furious. Their power as a body had, of course, been stripped away by Augustus a long, long time ago. But the pleasant fictions of the Principate had allowed senators to maintain some dignity over the following centuries. They ran provinces, they ratified decisions, and as individuals, they joined in the administrations of just about every emperor. But now, that too was all over. Diocletian's vision of an autocratic, centrally planned and centrally governed empire was absolute, and he had no intention of letting a few wealthy Italians, who used to be somebody, we swear, get in his way. His first and most obvious move towards eradicating the Senate from imperial affairs, as we've already seen, was to simply never go to Rome. Power is usually established by proximity to power, and the Senate was now, physically, nowhere near power. But Diocletian went further than that. Previous emperors had allowed the Senate to continue running the old senatorial provinces of the Augustan constitutional settlements, the most important of these being the provinces of Africa and Asia. They never wielded anything like final authority, but senators were appointed governors of these provinces, and the Senate as a body still deliberated what to do with them, with the full understanding that any time the emperor wanted to, he could step in and do or undo whatever he wanted. But still, they had a little tiny chip in the game. When Diocletian reorganized the empire, though, that chip was taken away, as he obliterated the old senatorial imperial provincial distinction. Plus, almost to a man, Diocletian's new provincial authorities were drawn from the equestrian class. He wanted smart, capable, career-minded men who owed their allegiance fully and completely to the emperor to be the ones out in the field running the show. The old aristocracy in Rome never quite gave up their sense of self-importance when they gave up their power, and Diocletian did not trust them to fall into line without hesitation or reservation. The only notice he took of their feelings is that when he divided up Italy along with the rest of the empire, he did allow senators to govern the individual Italian districts, though they were overseen by an equestrian vicar. From this point on, we see a shift in Roman politics. Robbed of any role to play in the empire they had created, the senators in Rome fell back into a merely local brand of politics. No longer was the pinnacle of a senator's career the consulship, the governorship, or the emperorship. It was instead the city prefecture, the mayor of Rome. Oh, how the mighty have fallen. And this was all undertaken, I think, not so much because Diocletian despised the Senate, as his attitude is sometimes reduced to, but instead because he disliked the untidiness of the old Augustan pseudo-partnership with them. Diocletian was, with every fiber of his being, an autocrat. He was not the type of man, like, say, Trajan had been, who encouraged his subordinates to figure it out for themselves. Diocletian wanted to control every single little detail of imperial administration, and then systematize that control so that it became permanent and unbreakable. To this end, he created the largest centralized bureaucracy staffed by career civil servants the Western world had ever seen, and then let it run the empire. In a later denunciation of Diocletian's policies, the bitterly hostile Christian writer Lactantius, who, as we'll soon see, had some very good reasons for being bitterly hostile, describes the enlargement of the imperial bureaucracy as creating a situation where the number of men being paid by the state was greater than the number of taxpayers paying into the state. This is, of course, a gross exaggeration, but there is no denying that Diocletian effectively doubled the number of civil servants over the course of his reign. But that doubling was from around 15,000 to maybe 30,000 in an empire with a total population of 20 to 50 million. So, no, there were not more bureaucrats than taxpayers. But yes, there were a lot more salarymen running around today than there were yesterday, and that did have a negative impact on the economy. The other thing to keep in mind, though, is that the new bureaucracy was not necessarily adding redundant layers to the administration of the empire. During the crisis years, a local civic government had essentially ceased all operations. All those town and city councils that had previously administered daily life had shuttered their doors, and someone had to step into the void. So, enter the imperial bureaucrat. The new bureaucracy was the flip side of that separation of civilian and military operations we talked about last week. Just as generals had gradually taken over the provincial governorships, the daily minutiae of governance was taken over by career soldiers on their staffs as well. Diocletian wanted to get the soldiers back to doing what they did best, and bring in trained professionals to do the work the military had by necessity taken over. But as he considered how the new administrative system was going to function, Diocletian decided that the one thing he liked about the military being in charge was the clear chains of command, the clear hierarchy of authority, and the clear specialization of function. So when he kicked the soldiers back to the frontiers, he essentially kept the structure of the military in place for his new bureaucracy, even as he staffed it with civilians. Bureaucrats were grouped into cohorts, just like in the legions, made answerable to senior officials, who were in turn grouped together and made answerable to another senior official, all the way up to the Praetorian Prefect and the Emperor. To make sure that no one missed the point, Diocletian even made the official uniform of his civil service a military cloak rather than a civilian toga. Most of these officials served out in the provinces collecting taxes, maintaining the public infrastructure, assessing property values, and so on and so on. But everyone was angling for a promotion to where the action and money really was, working directly for one of the emperors in one of the imperial capitals. Where once a few informal advisors had helped the emperor shape policy and make decisions, there was now a staff of literally thousands, carefully regimented into different departments, all scurrying to and fro, issuing memoranda, making recommendations, and implementing policy. These departments became known as scrinia, named after the boxes the officials used to hold all of their paperwork in while traveling with the emperor. And there was a scrinia for everything. Foreign affairs, protocol, correspondence in Latin, correspondence in Greek, petitions, favors, law, finance, on and on. Each scrinia had a department head, the equivalent of a cabinet minister or a cabinet secretary, who, when grouped together, became known as the consistory, the permanent body of advisors who surrounded the emperor. The most important of all of these officials, and the one who was really in charge of running the show on a day-to-day basis, was the Praetorian Prefect, who in terms of power, both de facto and de jure, was second only to the emperor. The office of Praetorian Prefect had, over the years, evolved well beyond simply being the captain of the imperial bodyguard. Lucius Sejanus had been the first to assume administrative and political functions, and for the next century and a half, the trajectory of the office had been consistently away from its old military functions and towards an exclusively political one. When Septimius Severus disbanded and then reformed the Praetorians, though, the prefects once again wielded real military authority. But when Diocletian took power, the Praetorians were reformed once more, this time reduced to simply serving as the local city garrison of Rome, which, as you'll recall, put them nowhere near the emperor or power. But the office of Praetorian Prefect was maintained, for I guess sentimental reasons, and Diocletian placed the prefect squarely at the top of his new bureaucracy. In effect, the prefect became a vice emperor, and it was his job to make sure that the vast new bureaucracy, including the hundreds of staffers that he personally employed, ran as smoothly as it could. But even more than that, his job was to share in the emperor's workload. For most agenda items, the signature of the prefect was just as good as the signature of the emperor, which meant that twice as much could now be done in the same amount of time. In the later part of his reign, Diocletian even went so far as to issue an edict stating that judicial decisions issued by the prefect were no longer appealable to the emperor. You could appeal to the emperor, or you could appeal to the prefect, but you couldn't do both. The prefect was, in short, a really, really powerful guy, and not at all someone you wanted to mess with. So those are the basics of the bureaucracy. Imperial agents out in the field were answerable to the officials who ran the regional offices, who were answerable to their superiors in the cabinet ministries, who were answerable to the department heads, who were answerable to the Praetorian Prefect, who was answerable to the Emperor. Throw in the parallel and sometimes intertwined tracks that introduce provincial governors and vicars of the diocese, and what you get is a hugely expanded, centrally run civil service that now governed the whole empire with its own code of ethics, standards, and loyalties. The famously ritualized and labyrinth administrations that came to define the Byzantine Empire, and indeed gave rise to the adjective Byzantine to describe something so multi-layered, overly complicated, and self-perpetuating that it confounds the mind, found its first form back here in the years of the Tetrarchy, as Diocletian sought to bring back adequate governance to the empire. The one thing we haven't really talked about, though, is perhaps Diocletian's most famous reform of all, the nature of the imperial office itself. I mentioned something about it when I was discussing Diocletian's desire to rest his legitimacy on divine authority rather than the approval of the legions or the consent of the Senate. But I didn't really talk about how it worked in practice, how Diocletian, on a daily basis, transformed the Principate into the dominant. At its most basic level, the transformation took place on a physical level. And it was from these physical changes that Diocletian expected the psychology of his subjects to shift. First and foremost, access to the emperor was severely restricted. He was kept secluded behind doors and officials and guards and more doors and more officials and more guards and then long hallways and more doors until by the time you actually got to the emperor, it was like you were setting foot in some holy inner sanctum. The Principate had been predicated on a calculated intimacy with emperors going out of their way to show that they were just one of the guys, whether inviting senators over for dinner or sharing in the hardships of the soldiers. Now it was the exact opposite, with calculated aloofness creating the impression that the emperor was a near mythical figure. Gibbon remarked that Augustus's model sought to conceal the real power of the emperors, while Diocletian's sought to display it. And by keeping the emperor hidden from view, the people's imaginations, with regards to the extent of his almost supernatural powers, began to run freely. Beyond this, there were dozens of subtle shifts. When the consistory met, all the ministers stood while the emperor remained seated. You'll recall that Julius Caesar's fate was practically sealed when he failed to rise to meet a delegation from the Senate, so this was actually a pretty big deal. Upon meeting with the emperor, it was expected that you kiss his robe as a sign of submission, something that would have been absolutely offensive to the Romans of old. But even more offensive might have been the reappearance of that universal symbol of royal authority, the diadem, which he took to wearing along with rich and bejeweled royal robes. The point of all this, as I mentioned before, was not so that Diocletian could indulge his vanity or his megalomania, but so that he could impress upon his subjects that the emperor was indeed above and beyond them. He literally shimmered in the light, never rising from his throne as supplicants cautiously approached to kiss his robes. The empire needed a strong authority figure to reassert order over an empire that had nearly come crashing down, and Diocletian aimed to give it to them in spades. The emperor was no longer princeps, the first citizen. He was dominus, the lord of the empire, and there would be no going back. Taken together, Diocletian's reordering of the governmental apparatus ushered in a whole new era for the Roman Empire and did nothing less than set the stage for the Byzantine Empire that would carry on Rome's legacy into the Middle Ages. All pretense of public government had now been cast aside. All claims of regional autonomy had now been cast aside. And any hint that the emperor might not be some sort of demigod ruling from a divine palace in the sky had definitely been cast aside. Perhaps, most importantly, by abandoning Rome as the capital and reorganizing Italy as just another province, the Roman Empire was finally cut adrift from its Roman heritage, which is, incidentally, how the East was able to keep right on going even after Rome itself had fallen into barbarism. The empire was now, more than ever, a single unit commanded from the center and functioning for the betterment of the whole without regard to tradition, feelings, or even private interest. No more was it first citizen and fellow citizens. It was now ruler and ruled, plain, simple, and laid bare for all to see. Next week, we will see how much this new dynamic of ruler and ruled came to alter the daily lives of the citizens, as Diocletian will seek to control not just the apparatus that governed them, but the economy that they swam in. And it was here that he finally met his match, because if there was one field Diocletian failed to master, it was economics. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 127, Commanding the Economy. When Diocletian first came into office, the Roman economy was pretty much just limping along. In the critical agricultural sector, the combination of war, plague, and forced migration had left Rome with fewer people, harvesting fewer crops from fewer functional farms. In the less critical but still important urban centers, the hardships of the past 50 years had essentially brought construction, trade, skilled craft, and banking to a standstill. But as with everything else, Diocletian was optimistic about the future. He had big fancy plans for the economy, and turning it into what he wanted to turn everything into, a rational, centrally controlled mechanism that, once organized properly, would begin producing wealth for everyone in quantities not seen in years. Yes, the problem of inflation would put a kink in his plans, but Diocletian was determined to see the Roman economy reinvented, and by the time he abdicated, economic activity in the empire had taken on an almost wholly different character from what it had been before. Part of the change was the result of the natural evolutionary forces of civilization, but much of it was the result of the reforms Diocletian himself initiated. Just to give you an idea of where we're going, I want to talk today about four things. The attempt to stabilize the currency, the reorganization of the tax structure, the calcification of professions, and finally, the edict on prices, which, though it achieved basically nothing, is a fascinating bit of history nonetheless. So, yeah, it has finally happened. Years of misguided imperial fiscal policy have finally ruined the currency of the Roman Empire. By the 280s AD, prices had begun to soar, wages had become inadequate, and savings were wiped out. It was bound to happen. As I mentioned before, the sheer volume of base metal coins flooding out into circulation would eventually cause major problems for the empire, and it was during the reign of Diocletian that those chickens finally came home to roost. Which was a particularly maddening state of affairs for the senior Augustus, because in almost every other respect, the empire was recovering from its brush with death. But when it came to the money, not only was the wound not healing, it had only just begun to bleed, and no one knew how to stop it. As with his predecessors, Diocletian understood that there was something inherently dangerous about making the coins of the empire literally less valuable. Of course, that hadn't stopped his predecessors from going ahead and debasing the coins anyway, but they all sort of grasped that they were playing with fire, which is why debasement went on in secret. Aurelian had finally arrested the free fall and even turned back the tide a bit, and Diocletian hoped to follow his lead and bring the currency of the Roman Empire back into respectability. To this end, he ordered that a new hierarchy of 5 coins begin circulation immediately, based on the old 3-metal system. 2 copper coins and 1 silver-copper mixed coin for everyday transactions. 1 nearly pure silver coin, something which had not been seen in years, for larger purposes, and 1 high-grade gold coin reserved for major payments, those usually coming from or going to the imperial government. One of the side effects of debasement had been that cheap silver coins had pushed the more common copper coins, the dollars and cents used on a daily basis by the population, out of circulation, which threw the whole system completely out of whack. Diocletian hoped that his new hierarchy would return balance to the system, but unfortunately, no dice. See, while there is no denying that the coins Diocletian issued during this period were of far better quality than what had been released over the course of the preceding generation, Diocletian was not practicing monetary policy in a vacuum. Had his new currency system been set up on a blank slate, it probably would have worked great. But the Roman Empire, at the end of the 3rd century, was anything but a blank slate. There were just millions and millions of bad coins already out there, and given the shortage of precious metals and the exacting standards Diocletian was trying to reassert in the mints, his new coins were simply unable to make a big enough impact to really curb inflation. Plus, the Romans didn't really understand the root of the problem, and so they missed what is today obvious to us. It is not necessarily the intrinsic value of the coin that is important to setting prices. It is rather the number of coins in circulation. Now, the Romans weren't complete dummies. They understood the basics of scarcity and abundance. After all, they lived and died each year with crop failures and bumper harvests driving the prices of grain all over the map. But they never made the leap to understanding that the same laws affect currency. To the Romans, currency was a stable element. A coin was worth exactly what it was worth, whether there were 500 in circulation or 5 million. And the thing is, for the most part, that had been true in their experience. The price of goods and the wages of workers and soldiers changed very little over the centuries, in sharp contrast to our own experience of that trip to the movie costing more with each passing year. So they just failed to grasp that the sheer tonnage of coins out in the marketplace was affecting the purchasing power of all those coins. And here was Diocletian issuing even more coins. Better coins, yes, but still, more. And this is where the emperor and his advisors made their biggest mistake. They did not call back in nearly enough of the old coins. They cycled some out of circulation, but if he really wanted the currency put back on sound footing, Diocletian needed to put the recall of all the bad coins at the center of his policy, and he just did not do it. As a result, his new five-coin system, while definitely introducing an element of stability, failed to do what the emperor wanted it to do. And unfortunately, he did not recognize that he had made this mistake. So when inflation continued, even after he launched his good coin policy, he looked elsewhere for the causes, and as we'll see, he wound up far afield, blaming people, places, and things that had nothing at all to do with the real underlying issue. As he waited patiently for the currency to revalue itself, and then watched helplessly as it did not, Diocletian still had an empire to pay for, and he understood instinctively that he couldn't afford to rely on the cash anymore. Taxes paid in cash were worthless. Wages paid in cash were worthless. If Diocletian was going to keep the empire functioning, and just to be clear, when I'm talking about the empire, what I really mean is the army, for the time being, taxes and wages were going to have to be assessed and paid by some standard other than money, something real and tangible, or at least something that seemed real and tangible. For this, Diocletian and his advisors concocted an elaborate and really ingenious new system to calculate imperial revenue and imperial expenses that cut out the middleman of cash and was based instead directly on the goods and services that money was supposed to be able to purchase. The origins of Diocletian's new system of taxation lay in the way the army had come to rely on forced requisition to supply itself during the latter part of the crisis years. When times had been good and the money was sound, everything was done on the up and up, with the army purchasing goods and services from contractors more than willing to do business with the legions. When times got tougher, the goods and services were still purchased by the army, but from far less willing sellers, and commanders often invoked a proto-version of today's eminent domain laws, whereby in an emergency, the sale of goods and services were compellable by law. When times got really tough, and the money had become a joke, commanders no longer even bothered with the farce of compulsive transactions, and simply took what they needed. This new means of supplying themselves naturally changed the way that officers and soldiers were paid, as money had simply stopped being a functional medium of exchange. Officers and soldiers were now paid in kind, that is, with the goods themselves, rather than the money to purchase the goods. Grain, shirts, meat, blankets, shoes, whatever was around that approximated what a man would have purchased had his money been worth anything. It used to be that all of these items would have been deducted from a soldier's pay by the quartermaster. Now, they were the pay. This was the army that Diocletian had spent the majority of his career in, and though it is clear he was no fan of forced requisition because of the damage it did to the bonds of civil society, he understood that it was necessary. When he became emperor, then, his ideas about how to extract resources from his subjects and how to pass them along to his soldiers was informed by his experience with this ad hoc system of requisition and in-kind payment. But it shouldn't surprise you to learn that the thing that bugged Diocletian the most about the system was how random, arbitrary, and untidy it all was. So he set about to make the empire's new tax structure less all those things. In order to run a proper army, there were certain things a general learned by heart. If he had 1,000 men to feed, clothe, and shelter, he knew exactly how much timber he was going to need, how much wine he was going to need, how many horses he was going to need, and how many boots he was going to need. The army, in fact, had this practically down to a science. They knew down to the fraction of everything how much one soldier was going to add to their supply burden. Diocletian simply took this understanding and blew it up to an empire-wide level. Since the money was no longer any good, Diocletian just added up everything the imperial government required to outfit its army and bureaucracy for 1 year, which is the very first annual budget in the Western world, by the way, and then ordered his subjects to supply him with what he needed. But of course, the regions of the empire did not produce goods and services on a uniform basis. One city may specialize in textile production with nary a pig farmer in sight, while another may have abundant wheat fields but no brickworks. So you couldn't just divide up the list and demand everyone pony up the same fractions of everything. What Diocletian needed was a way of reducing what a man legally owed in taxes to some standard unit of measurement and exchange. Kind of like money, except we can't use money because the money is no good. So the answer was a new theoretical unit of exchange. Basically, what the emperor and his advisors did was take everything listed in the new annual budget and make a giant equivalency chart to track the relative value of all the items. So many bushels of wheat equals so many shirts equals so many miles of transportation provided equals so many chickens, and so on. Then they reduced the total of everything down to manageable fractions and used that as the basis for taxation. So Farmer Gaius, who doesn't owe cash really anymore, also doesn't owe half a shoe and two-thirds of a shirt and a quarter of a blanket. Instead, he owes 5 units of tax, payable in whatever good or service he can most easily provide. In this case, probably bushels of wheat. Mule driver Publius, on the other hand, pays his 5 units of tax by transporting some swords the army needs from point A to point B. There is an inherent danger, of course, in that, well, what if everyone satisfies their allotment of tax by paying in pigs? But apparently it never came up, and the diversification of the empire's economy produced, mostly of its own accord, the supplies Diocletian demanded. The other question, then, was how do you assess how much a person is required to supply? For this, Diocletian turned to his newly enlarged bureaucracy. They fanned out across the empire and cataloged everything. They counted every man, woman, child, and slave. They counted how many chickens you had, and how many horses you had, and how many acres you owned, and what was being grown on them. They noted your profession, your skills, your physical strength, and they drew it all up on a ledger. Then they asked around to see if you were hiding anything. Once everything was cataloged, the empire was reduced to 2 basic units, manpower and land, which is how imperial agents determine what your share of the tax burden was going to be. Both units were calculated with some nuance, with women and children being counted for less in the manpower department, and rich land being valued differently from poor land, because Diocletian was actually sensitive to matters of fairness. As I said, one of the problems he had with forced requisition was that it was arbitrary and cruel. So Diocletian really was trying to put in place a system that would take a man's particular circumstances into account, rather than just laying some blanket levy on his head, whether his 10 acres were prized vineyards or a rocky mountainside. So this is how it worked then. And I'll just make some numbers up here. Let's say your city has 500 units of land and 200 units of manpower. Well, according to our calculations, you collectively owe 75 units of tax. You can pay with whatever you've got. Shirts, bricks, timber, pigs. Just make sure that we get it. Payable in 3 yearly installments to account for spoilage. Thank you, and see you next year. Diocletian's solution was an ingenious way to get around the inflation issue, and in no time, the empire was reaping tax harvests like the good old days. Well, more even than the good old days. Back in its various golden ages, Rome had actually been pretty loose about taxes. As long as enough was coming in, they never really questioned whether there was more to be had, or whether they could be exploiting their empire more efficiently. But after systematically cataloging every single thing in the empire, and then applying a uniform system of collection, Diocletian was able to extract resources from his subjects at a previously unimagined level. He didn't take everything, of course. That would have been counterproductive. Diocletian kept to Tiberius's old maxim that the sheep must be shorn and not skinned. But he now had a far more exact idea of how close he could get without skinning the sheep. Unfortunately, his successors would not be so exact, a problem that we will get to in future episodes. But in his attempt to mobilize the resources of the empire as quickly and efficiently as possible, Diocletian did not stop with tax policy. He also inserted the imperial government directly into the economy in ways that had never been seen before. As I mentioned last week, Diocletian wanted the empire to function as one unified mechanism to maximize its power. But that did not mean just paying attention to the big stuff. It also meant ensuring that all the little screws and cogs and springs were where they needed to be, doing what they needed to do. In other words, the free market is about to become a lot less free. The rigid tentacles of the state first worked their way into the economy by way of the trade guilds, and from there extended themselves until they touched every man, woman, and child in the empire. Diocletian was not insensible to the danger that his new tax system would fall apart if everyone paid in pigs, and he was well aware that the chaos of the previous decades had caused massive population upheavals and severe shifts in the economic output of whole swaths of the empire. In other words, if he wasn't careful, the diversified economy Diocletian needed to make his new tax system work would collapse down into a few subsistence industries, with everything else being abandoned as an unsustainable luxury. Worse yet, many of the jobs that needed doing were not at all happy fun jobs. What if young Publius, son of Publius the mule driver, decides that he doesn't want to follow in his father's footsteps? What if all the sons of all the mule drivers decide that? Pretty soon, there will be no mule drivers left. It is entirely likely that had he not gotten into it, everything would have worked out fine, but Diocletian was never one to not get into something. As I just said, it started with the trade guilds. One of the first to be enveloped was the Guild of Shippers, who brought the grain from Africa to Italy. After doing business with the empire for centuries as an independent corporation, Diocletian simply took it over and declared the guild an arm of the government, and then took over wages and prices. Then it said that if you wanted to ship anything into Italy, you had to join the government's guild. And oh yeah, once you've joined, you can't resign. He followed that same pattern with everyone, brickmakers, cobblers, architects, whoever. Wherever there was a voluntary association of professionals, Diocletian would come in, co-opt it, make it compulsory, and then make it hereditary. This process was amongst the most gradual of his career, but by the time Diocletian abdicated, most of the empire's citizens were attached to some sort of imperially mandated guild that compelled them to keep the job they had been doing. And it further compelled their sons to join the guild, and then their sons to join the guild after that. So, if by some random chance you were a tanner in the late 3rd century, that meant that your family was now, forever, tanners. Same for potters and teachers and fishermen. And of course, same for farmers. On top of everything else, you weren't even allowed to move anymore without permission, even if you planned to keep the same job, because Diocletian didn't want industries to die off in a given city due to unplanned population migrations. If you think this sounds an awful lot like the beginnings of medieval serfdom, then gold star for you. We are, right now, transitioning away from the Roman Empire of old and into pre-feudal society. Diocletian was the author of a lot of what defines the next 1,000 years of history. He did it as a response to the particular economic necessities of his day, but once it all took root, it really took root. One thing he did that most definitely did not take root is the last thing I want to talk about today, the infamous Edict on Maximum Prices, which represented Diocletian's last furious attempt to put a stop to inflationary prices. I don't want to spend too much time on it because, well, it was more or less abandoned an hour and a half after it was issued, but still, it is a fascinating little piece of history that deserves some attention, for no other reason than it lets us know that the Romans had 3 kinds of beer, Pannonian, Celtic, and Egyptian, and that the Egyptian kind was considered half as good as the other two, because apparently Egyptian beer was the Schlitz of the ancient world. After 16 years on the throne, Inflation continued to ravage the empire, and nothing Diocletian did seemed to even slow it down. Though his tax structure had been mostly taken off the gold, silver, copper standard, there was no getting away from currency completely, and it drove Diocletian crazy that he could never ensure that wages kept up with prices, especially when it came to his soldiers. Paid to risk their lives in defense of the empire, Diocletian was outraged every time he heard of a soldier being forced to drop a whole year's pay on a single shirt. Price gouging and war profiteering was nothing new, but things had gotten ridiculous, and Diocletian decided that the main culprits were the evil, no-good merchants who were taking advantage of the situation. They were thieving the life savings of good, honest, hard-working soldiers, and it had to stop. In 301, Diocletian had finally had enough, and he issued in typical Diocletianic fashion an encyclopedic edict divided into 32 sections, breaking down practically every single thing that could be bought and sold, and then setting a maximum price for it. The emperor was careful to note that he was not setting the price. He was only setting the maximum price. If you wanted to charge less, that was your prerogative. Just don't charge more. If you charged more, the edict was crystal clear in the consequences of your greed. Death. Of course, even with the death penalty hanging over their heads, no one paid any attention to the edict. No one had any motivation to turn anyone in for violating it, and everyone paid the going rate for everything, just as usually happens when draconian price controls are put into effect. But nonetheless, the edict was carved in stone and posted all over the empire, so we get to learn fascinating things about what an idealized version of Roman economic values looks like. Per-day farm laborers made 25 denarii a day, compared to the 50 earned by a stonemason or a cabinet maker. There were 7 kinds of wine, all listed at 30 denarii each, and one, listed as simply ordinary wine, which sold for just 16. Aged wine actually lowered the price, as each of the 7 more expensive varieties dropped to 24 denarii once it was a year old. A lawyer could make 1,000 denarii for pleading a case, and 250 just for filing the opening paperwork. Our old friend Publius the mule driver would have made, with maintenance, 25 denarii per day, or 4 denarii per mile, for one mule load of goods. Every kind of grain, seed, or bean you can think of gets its due price, as does every kind of shoe, boot, sandal, and shirt imaginable. Famously, the most expensive item listed is 1 pound of purple-dyed silk, which a merchant was not allowed to charge more than 150,000 denarii for. And since the only person who was probably buying purple-dyed silk by the pound was the emperor himself, I'd wager to guess that it was maybe one of the few items that actually went for the price listed. As I said, the edict was quietly abandoned just a few years after it was issued, and many historians believe that Maximian and Constantius never even got around to announcing it because they recognized what a terribly unenforceable idea it was. But for a while there, wherever Diocletian went, so went the price edict, until even he began to recognize that he was tilting at windmills. That was right around the time he decided to retire. Not that the two are in any way connected. With that, I'll bring to a close our brief little tour through Diocletian's reforms. We've seen the deep impact he had on the military, the government, and the economy, and in many respects, he was as transformative a figure as Rome had ever known. The empire Diocletian inherited was not the same one he bequeathed to his successors. And perhaps even more importantly, the answer to the age-old question, are you better off now than you were 4 years ago, was almost everywhere a resounding yes. Which is to say that there is nothing at all that prevents us from comfortably placing Diocletian among the top 5 emperors of all time. Next week, though, we'll start to get into why we can't put him at the very top of the pile, and some of the curious moves he made at the end of his reign that damaged the stability of the empire, stability that he had worked so hard to establish, so that when he handed the reins of power off, his successors were more than able and more than willing to take Rome right back into the snake pit of civil war. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 128, The Great Persecution. As we've seen over the course of the past few episodes, the first 15 years of Diocletian's reign represented a sea change for the Roman Empire. Some of the reforms he initiated were embraced as long overdue, while others were fought tooth and nail every step of the way. For example, the uprisings in Egypt triggered by the crackdown on tax evaders. Some of his reforms did not outlast his reign, while others became the entrenched status quo for 1,000 years or more, while others, like the Price Edict, never even got off the ground. But all in all, there is no question that Diocletian had taken an empire that was adrift and placed it back on solid ground. And impressively, he had done all this with a minimum of ill-advised screw-ups. That is, Diocletian sometimes pursued policies that were disruptive, and sometimes he pursued policies that wound up producing no tangible benefits, but he almost never pursued policies that were both at the same time. I think it's fair to say that this week, we will see him pursue a policy that was both in spades. And ironically, for all that Diocletian did right, it was this thing he did wrong that wound up changing the world more than anything else. The trouble started in 299 AD, not long after Galerius returned to Antioch in triumph, having just defeated the Sassanids. Diocletian and Galerius were together in the imperial residence and decided to have some divinations taken to find out what the future looked like from a metaphysical point of view. But every time the priest reached in to inspect the entrails of a sacrificial animal, he announced that something had gone wrong. Something was preventing him from getting a proper reading. After enduring attempt after attempt, it was finally brought to Diocletian's attention that certain members of the household staff were Christian, and that they had been seen making the sign of the cross to ward off evil demons, aka the gods Diocletian was trying to contact. In other words, these Christians were intentionally sabotaging the emperor's divinations. Diocletian was furious, and immediately ordered all members of his household to make a sacrifice to the gods, and if they refused, they were to be fired. Then, egged on by Galerius and a few other staunchly anti-Christian advisors, he extended his order to the army. Every officer and soldier in the legions was to make a sacrifice. Refusal meant immediate discharge. Diocletian was at heart a deeply conservative man who was trying to restore the glory of the Roman Empire. His desire to connect imperial authority to Jupiter and the other Olympian gods was, for him, not necessarily just cynical propaganda. He very much wanted to get Rome back on the side of the gods who had made the empire great, and he spent lavishly on temples and sacrifices and memorials throughout the provinces to help make that happen. Now, following the reasoning of Decius, Diocletian began to suspect that the continued existence of the antisocial, impious, and sacrilegious Christians was doing serious damage to the relationship between Rome and her gods. So he began to suspect that it was time for them to go. But he was also at heart a deeply pragmatic man, and wide-scale religious purges can rarely be filed under P for pragmatic. So with his religious conservatism coming into conflict with his political pragmatism, Diocletian turned to his advisors for, well, advice. With Galerius taking the lead, they came back to him with the nearly unanimous conclusion that in this case, his religious instincts must take precedence. Christianity needed to be stamped out once and for all. We have, up until this point, only dealt with the Christians in passing, usually as they intersected with imperial affairs, like when Nero blamed them for the Great Fire, or when Pliny asked Trajan what to do about them. But since Christianity is about to become one of the core defining elements of the Roman Empire, I think I should probably take this moment to give a brief thumbnail sketch of the first 300 years of the church so we can get a feel for what it is exactly Diocletian is about to try to stamp out, and what it is exactly that in just a few years will become the most powerful non-imperial institution in the empire. Now, by way of disclaimer, I'd like to say that I am not a church historian, and am not going to delve deeply into the myriad little controversies about, say, who wrote what gospels, when, why, and how. I just want to give a general overview of how Christianity developed, where it developed, and what it developed into over the course of its first three centuries. I am afraid that at times my vocabulary will be imprecise, but I hope that no one will find too much to argue with in the broad strokes. So as I'm sure you are no doubt aware, it is said that around 30 AD, a Jewish holy man from Nazareth named Jesus was put to death by Pontius Pilate, the Roman governor of Judea. Over the course of his brief career as a preacher, 3 years being the longest estimate I've seen, Jesus had won over a small band of adherents known as the disciples, and had earned fame throughout Galilee for his non-traditional interpretations of Jewish scripture and his potential for miracle working. He eventually ran afoul of the Jewish religious authorities, and when he arrived in Jerusalem for Passover, the exact year is unknown, he was arrested by Roman authorities either on sacrilegious or revolutionary grounds. He was found guilty of whatever crime he was charged with and crucified a few days later, which most people no doubt figured was the end of the ministry of Jesus. But the disciples of Jesus were not ready to abandon their leader's message. They continued to meet and worship as he had instructed them to do, and continued to convert their fellow Jews to their way of life. The early church was focused on Jesus' role as the prophesied Jewish Messiah, and that per his teachings, he would soon return from the dead to oversee an apocalypse that would pave the way for the establishment of the kingdom of God on earth. The early Christians expected this second coming at any moment, and lived their lives accordingly. But as the years passed and Jesus did not return, the imminency of the second coming was emphasized less, and other, more immediate concerns began to demand the attention of the Christian leadership. The first major concern for the growing church was the question of the Gentiles, that is, non-Israelites. Initially, Christianity was an exclusively Jewish sect. Every Christian was a practicing Jew, they just happened to believe in a few extra things that were not believed by mainstream Judaism. But as the first generation of disciples went out into the wider Greco-Roman world, they often found willing non-Jewish adherents. So, are they allowed to be Christian, or what? Some Christian leaders said yes, and others said no. As you probably already know, though, the drive to allow for Gentile conversion was driven by St. Paul, and his point of view eventually won out. Traditionally, the first Gentile Christian was a centurion named Cornelius, who was baptized by St. Peter himself, though that is one of those myriad little controversies that I am not going to wade into. The question of whether Christianity should retain its strictly Jewish character was answered early in the negative, but that question was merely the opening salvo in a long-running Christian debate about the nature of their religion. That is, whether the church ought to be composed of a select few who were pure in their faith and utterly devoted in life, or whether it should make a play at becoming the universal religion of the world, which would inevitably involve clearing away most of the barriers to entry into the church. At the very beginning, it was understood that you had to be circumcised in order to be a true Christian, but that barrier was quickly dropped to allow for Gentile adherence. What other barriers should be dropped? What barriers could not be dropped? Though that initial question was resolved, the tension between big tent and small tent Christians would never go away, and every generation some new controversy would flare up that pitted purists against expansionists. The second century saw the passing away of the original disciples and gospel writers, and the rise of an independent Christianity with its own hierarchy of command, separate from all other religions in the empire. Up until the Great Jewish Revolt, Jerusalem had naturally acted as the de facto capital of Christianity, since it was, after all, a Jewish sect. But after Jerusalem fell in 70 AD, the church began to separate itself permanently from Judaism, culminating most visibly in the Christian refusal to join in the Third Jewish War of the 130s AD. The Romans themselves by that point had already determined the two religions were separate, and a tax edict issued by Nerva explicitly denies to Christians the special exemptions enjoyed by the Jews. See, the Romans liked people to get on board with the Roman way of doing things, and the Jews had always given them trouble on that front. But the Romans were also deeply impressed with the sheer ancientness of Judaism, and so, more or less, let the Jews conform to Roman rule in their own way. But the Christians were recognized as a newfangled thing, owed no such deference. Jesus' church, which had once been just a little sect of Judaism, was now, for better or for worse, its own independent thing. The other major consequence of the sack of Jerusalem is that the Christian movement also became far more decentralized. With Jerusalem out of the picture, the local leadership of each of the Christian centers now took command of their parishes and ran them as they saw fit. Ironically, though, just as the church as a whole was becoming less centralized, the chain of command at the local level was becoming more centralized. Over the years, the Christians developed a system whereby each city had its own chain of authority, with deacons at the lowest rung doing the daily work of tending to the sick and poor, the next run of presbyters, who would become today's priests, acting as a sort of governing council, and at the top, the bishop, who was the supreme religious authority in his district, which usually meant that he issued clarifications on the differences between a true and a false teaching. Naturally, the bishops of the largest cities, Rome, Antioch, and Alexandria, came to exert an extra bit of authority over their surrounding territories, and the Bishop of Rome in particular claimed a higher authority even than that, both because he sat in the capital of the empire and because his seat had been founded by St. Peter himself. But if you'd like to enjoy an entertaining conniption fit, just ask the Bishop of Alexandria what he thinks about the primacy of Peter. Since the main role of the bishop was to establish the difference between what was a true and what was a false teaching, we must ask the question then, what happened when the bishops disagreed with each other? And that, my friends, is the $10,000 question of early Christian history. The church was not some sort of hive mind, and the various bishops disagreed with each other frequently, passionately, and sometimes violently about almost everything under the sun. And these were serious disagreements. This was not, I think what that guy over there is teaching is true, and you think what that guy over there is teaching is false. It was rather, I think what I am teaching is true, and I think that what you are teaching is false. Excommunications and counter-excommunications began to proliferate, and sometimes succession to a major bishopric began to look like succession to the imperial throne, with supporters of the new bishop purging supporters of the old bishop, stripping them of their priesthoods and kicking them out of the church, only to have the whole drama play out in reverse a few years later. It is truly a wonder that Christianity managed to maintain any sort of cohesion at all during this period. But enough of the bishops had enough of an interest in preventing a major schism that they would meet in councils, summits really, and hash out their differences, force each other to compromise, and try to put these controversies to rest. But just as one issue was put to bed, another would pop up, threatening a split all over again. And we haven't even gotten to the really big controversies of the 3rd and 4th centuries yet. The 3rd century was as tumultuous for the Christians as it was for everyone else. Though Christianity had always been an outlaw religion, and had found itself the victim of periodic local persecutions, in Rome under Nero, in Gaul during the reign of Marcus Aurelius, and so on, Imperial policy rarely took notice of them. Trajan's advice to Pliny that he ought to ignore the Christians unless they did something really wrong seemed to be standard operating procedure. But as the empire fell into chaos, the Christians for the first time felt the sting of coordinated imperial attack. Maximinus Thrax ordered the first major attack on Christianity, though he limited the scope of his persecutions to the bishops. 15 years later, attempting to get Rome back on the right side of the gods, Decius broadened the scope of persecution to include all Christians, which not only resulted in confiscations and executions across the empire, but also a major split within the church between leaders who advocated compliance and those, particularly in North Africa, who advocated resistance. The latter would eventually be shouted down and declared heretical when the Decian persecutions was over. But this episode foreshadowed the later, larger fight with the Donatists, who advocated similar resistance to Diocletian's persecutions, or more accurately, resistance to those who acquiesced to them. But just as it seemed like things were going from bad to worse for the Christians, the empire was falling apart, and the emperors were now specifically targeting them for harassment, Christianity suddenly enjoyed an unprecedented run of growth and acceptance. Gallienus canceled the Decian persecution on the grounds that it was unnecessary and unjust, and the Illyrian emperors had way more important things on their minds. So from 260 until about 300, the stigma attached to Christianity was muted. So much so that the religion that had once been derided as a religion of women and slaves now counted amongst its number wealthy and influential men. Slaves were now joined by their masters. Wives were now joined by their husbands, common soldiers by their officers, the poor by the rich. Churches ceased to be little hovels hidden away deep in the maze of an inner city, and were now being built right out in the open. By 300 AD, in fact, a church sat on a hill in Nicomedia overlooking the imperial palace. Christians were still in the minority by a substantial margin across the empire, but they were estimated by this point to account for about 10% of the population, which was nothing to sneeze at. Over the course of the past three centuries, the little sect of heretical Jews led by a messianic holy man from Nazareth had grown to be the largest monotheistic religion in the empire and a social force with real teeth, which is, perhaps, what troubled Diocletian's advisors the most. Of all the myriad differences between Christians and pagans, perhaps no single difference loomed larger in the minds of imperial authorities than just how structured Christianity was. Yes, the church functioned politically more as a loose oligarchy of bishops than as some unified autocracy, but still, no pagan cult could come close to matching the empire-wide network of institutionalized authority that Christianity boasted. It was nothing less than a parallel command structure to the state. And if you listen to Christian rhetoric for any length of time, you would find that most of them believed that their command structure actually superseded the state's, render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, notwithstanding. The fact that roughly 10% of the population was now Christian and adhered to that command structure scared the hell out of many in the government. Plus, that 90-10 split is a bit misleading, because Christianity was still clustered in the cities at this point, so their minority share seemed that much larger to government officials living in those same cities. Coupled with genuine fears of organized revolution, there was also the fact that the church was beginning to raise funds in unprecedented sums, as wealthy patrons began to render unto God whatever they weren't rendering unto Caesar. So when we ask the question, why were Diocletian's advisors so keen on taking the Christians out? The answer essentially boils down to protection of the status quo. They were amongst the greatest beneficiaries of it, and the Christians were amongst the greatest threats to it. So this is all mostly a case of entrenched power making a preemptive strike against a potential rival. But following the initial purge of the imperial household and the army, tempers cooled some. The purge of the army was, in fact, unevenly enforced at best. And it wasn't until the winter of 302-303 that things really got rolling again. Not that Diocletian hadn't been gearing up for the fight in the meantime. In 301, he had visited Egypt and encountered problems with the Manichaeans, a religion similar to Christianity, both in substance and organization, which had become a hotbed for resistance to imperial authority. Diocletian was additionally troubled by the Manichaeans because their religion originated in Persia, and members still had close ties to their brethren in the East, meaning that they looked to Diocletian a lot like a Sassanid-aligned fifth column. So the Manichaeans were ruthlessly suppressed. Executions, exiles, confiscations, and destruction of scripture. In effect, a dry run for the great persecution of Christians that was coming down the chute. Diocletian and Galerius were in Nicomedia over the winter of 302-303 when things finally got going. The emperors had attempted to get a pronouncement on something or other from an oracle of Apollo, but the oracle instead announced that the, quote, impious on earth were preventing him from connecting with the gods. Diocletian huddled with his council to determine what this meant, and they were of one mind. It meant that the gods were angry at Rome for tolerating the Christians. I should mention at this point that it is widely believed that by now, Galerius was taking more of a lead in imperial policy, and as a fierce anti-Christian, that he was actually the driving force behind all of this. At its most all-encompassing, the blame Galerius for everything theory contends that the junior emperor arranged for the botched divination and the non-responsive oracle in order to push Diocletian into a hard-line stance. He will also be blamed for the fires that will break out following the publication of the first anti-Christian edict, which we'll get to in a second. However, though Galerius proved himself to be a sadist when it came to the Christians, it is really hard to say in the run-up to the persecution what events he prearranged and what events he simply took advantage of. On February 23, 303 AD, almost exactly 1,708 years ago, Diocletian finally let the hardliners off the leash. He ordered the Church of Nicomedia, the one that could be seen from his imperial palace, razed to the ground. All of the scripture housed there was burned, and all of its valuables were carted off. The next day, imperial authorities posted an edict, not only ordering every citizen in the empire to make a proper pagan sacrifice, but further ordering that every church in the empire was to be destroyed, all Christian scripture was to be burned, and known Christians be henceforth forbidden from assembling in one place. The public outcry was immediate, and the first victim of the persecution was a Christian man who literally tore the posted edict down off the wall. Within a week, fires began breaking out in the imperial palace. According to some sources, these were little Reichstag fires set by Galerius, and Diocletian's opinion hardened further. Now the Christian threat was not just theoretical. They were disobeying imperial orders and engaging in nothing less than treason. In the aftermath of this initial uprising, Christians were rounded up and tortured for information about their brethren, and Galerius seems to have had a particular penchant for burning victims alive once he was done extracting information from them. Then, when the first edict was determined to be insufficiently oppressive, a further law was passed in the summer of 303, ordering that church officials, all those deacons and presbyters and bishops, be rounded up and jailed. This, of course, caused the prisons to overflow, and regular criminals had to be released to allow for the influx of Christians. It was around this time that the backlash began. Hardline anti-Christians, for the most part, only lived in the uppermost rungs of the imperial government. Down on the lower levels, soldiers and guards and wardens had a hard time fathoming why they were being made to suffer under the crushing weight of thousands of harmless old men who had broken no real laws. In many cases, these men just outright lied to their superiors, telling them sacrifices had been dutifully made just so they could clear out the holding cells. This dynamic played out all over the empire, as the rigor with which the persecution was pursued became defined by local officials, who, more often than not, wanted no part of jailing and killing Christians. In the West especially, the Great Persecution never really gained traction. Constantius in particular seems to have set the tone for his territories, and after a few perfunctory photo ops, he essentially let the whole matter drop, which of course made him something of a hero within the church, allowing his son to easily play the part of Christian champion down the road. In the East, though, under the watchful eye of Galerius, Christians in Syria and Egypt and Asia Minor were rounded up, tortured, and more often than not, burned alive. The backlash in the eastern provinces, then, did not take the form of intentionally blind state officials, but instead ordinary citizens who were horrified at what the government was doing. The victims were their family, their friends, and their neighbors, and even if they were none of these things, the Christians were by this time widely viewed as a harmless cult comprised of law-abiding, tax-paying citizens, whose most visible public activity was, what, tending to the poor and the sick? On top of that, there was a whole growing community of Romans, like, for example, the Emperor Aurelian, who had drifted over to monotheism, even if it was a particularly pagan brand of it. They often identified the God of the Christians with their own God, and even if the Christians did not necessarily reciprocate, monotheists who watched fellow monotheists dragged off in chains were incensed. Across the East, citizens hid Christians, lied to protect Christians, helped Christians escape to the West, and in every way tried to thwart the imperial agents. The persecution's initial burst of energy lasted into 304, and would continue on the books until 311, but it would eventually be dropped by Galerius just prior to his death, after he finally came to understand that the whole operation had done far more to undermine imperial authority than bolster it. What happened between 304 and 311 to change Galerius's mind, you ask? How about the rise of Constantine the Great, whose career was in part fueled by citizens, Christian or otherwise, who viewed the persecution as an unthinkable crime against humanity? And that is why it appears Diocletian made a huge mistake in aligning himself with the hardliners. The persecution disrupted the peace he had spent the last 20 years establishing. It undermined the legitimacy of the Tetrarchy, paving the way for Constantine to eventually blow it up. And in return for all that, the persecution had produced for Diocletian no tangible benefits. It was a bad policy and a bloody policy, and stands as a giant stain on Diocletian's otherwise sterling record. Next week, we will get into the only upside for Diocletian, namely, that in 305, he would wash his hands of the whole thing, and in an unprecedented move, announce that he planned to voluntarily abdicate the throne so he could retire to his villa and, I'm dead serious about this, raise cabbages. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 129, Abdication. Now that we know how everything turned out, I think it's safe to say that 303 AD marked the beginning of the end for Diocletian and his Tetrarchy. Beyond the great persecution and all the long-term ill effects that came with it, 303 also saw Diocletian stricken by an illness that plagued him for so long and was so nearly fatal that calling it a brush with death doesn't quite do it justice. It was more like an extended staring contest. When death finally blinked, though, Diocletian did not take it as a sign that he was destined to live and rule forever. Instead, He took it as a reminder that he was mortal, that he was not long for this world, and that it was time to initiate his last and most audacious plan yet. Despite the unpleasantness of the Great Persecution, 303 AD was otherwise supposed to be a banner year for the Tetrarchy. The Romans loved their anniversaries, and the year was about to see two big imperial milestones come to pass. In March, the two Caesars, Galerius and Constantius, would celebrate the 10th anniversary of their ascension to the purple, and in November, Diocletian would enter the 20th year of his reign. The senior Augustus had every intention of celebrating both anniversaries in unprecedented fashion, and so he took this opportunity to play the one card he had thus far kept hidden deep in his hand. After 20 years of neglect and disdain, it was finally time for the Emperor of Rome to visit Rome. Word went out to the citizens of the Eternal City that they were about to get their first look at Diocletian, and preparations immediately went into overdrive to greet him with all Rome had to offer. The city fathers saw it as an opportunity to fully impress upon Diocletian that whatever his political aims had been in refusing to visit the true capital of the empire, that Rome could not be denied forever. She was too big, too rich, and too important to simply fade away. Rome's day would come again, and they planned to make sure that Diocletian bore witness to that fact. For the lower classes, the imminent arrival of the emperor meant only one thing: festivals and games on a massive scale. It was with great anticipation then that the citizens of Rome awaited the imperial entourage, and when it finally arrived, no one was disappointed. No one, that is, except Diocletian. On his way to Rome, Diocletian swung through Milan and picked up Maximian, who, apart from a brief campaign in North Africa, had spent the last few years taking it easy in northern Italy. The two Augusti then entered Rome together in November of 303, just in time to welcome Diocletian's 20th anniversary year and inaugurate games that would simultaneously celebrate that milestone and the decade milestone of the two Caesars. The plan was then for him to remain in the city until January 1st, at which point he and Maximian would stand on the Capitoline Hill and be invested with the year's consulships. Hey, remember consulships? Just like the Romans of old. But it quickly became apparent that things were not going to go according to plan. Things started out all right, as Diocletian took a tour of the city to inspect the various building projects he had commissioned over the years. Despite his political disdain for the city, Diocletian had always been conscious of the symbolic importance of the old capital and felt that it would be in bad taste to let the city fall into disrepair. So when, for example, the Senate House burned down, Diocletian did not hesitate to rebuild it, and the Curia that stands in the Forum today is the ruin of Diocletian's final rebuild. The emperor also took the opportunity to put his own stamp on the city by building a huge bath complex in the northern quarter that rivaled the baths of Caracalla in both size and opulence, which were called, obviously, the Baths of Diocletian. But after satisfying himself that the city was in good shape architecturally, there was nothing left for him to do but enjoy all that Rome had to offer. And unfortunately, Diocletian did not at all enjoy what Rome had to offer. He was immediately put on edge by the attitude of the citizens, who he found himself face to face with for the first time. See, the Romans themselves were not so quick to embrace the notion that their emperor was a quasi-god who had descended from on high to rule them. That kind of BS might work on the lowly provincials, but in Rome, an emperor was just a man who had a lot of political power. There was nothing mystical about it. We invented this whole operation, for crying out loud. Don't try to tell us that you're made of magic. We know that somewhere behind all those curtains is a man just like us. After almost two decades of being treated with awed reverence wherever he went, it was a bit of a shock to be thrust into a world where the princeps model was still believed to be in effect. Diocletian found himself dealing with familiarity, vulgarity, and disrespect in degrees and quantities he had not experienced in years, and frankly, it put him off. This unpleasantness was then compounded by the behavior of the Romans at the games themselves. Diocletian was a conservative man, and perhaps a bit of a prude, but he was not naive as to the way the world worked, nor to the way that people worked. But still, what he saw in Rome shocked him. The drunkenness, the grubbiness, the licentiousness of it all contrasted sharply with his mental image of the Romans of old, an image that he himself had been trying to emulate all these years. Here now were the great Romans, crying over a lost chariot race, fighting over women, passing out in the streets from an excess of, well, everything. It was, in a word, disgusting. After just a few short weeks, Diocletian had had enough. Far from impressed, the emperor was now convinced more than ever that Rome was irrelevant. 20th anniversary or no, there was a whole empire out there that needed his attention, and he couldn't in good conscience continue to ignore it in favor of this drunken orgy. So he let it be known to everyone's shock and dismay that he was cutting his visit short, and that he would accept his consulship not on the Capitoline Hill, but instead on the road, getting him the hell out of Rome. The Romans, commoner and aristocrat alike, were bitterly disappointed, and not a little offended themselves that the emperor was snubbing them right to their face. In a few years, Maxentius will arrive on the scene and offer them the opportunity to extract a measure of revenge on Diocletian and his carefully laid plans for the empire. It should come as no surprise that they will jump at the chance to upset Diocletian's apple cart. Now, maybe it was just a coincidence, or maybe it was that Diocletian was getting old, but if you're feeling superstitious, there is no misinterpreting what happened next. On his way out of Italy, Diocletian came down with some sort of illness that basically knocked him out of commission for a year and a half. He could do no more than lay in a closed litter as the imperial entourage struggled to make its way back to Nicomedia. I am sure that there were more than a few whispers about whether or not the gods were perhaps a bit annoyed at Diocletian for the way he had just treated Rome. His advisors kept pleading with the emperor to stop the journey and settle down in any one of the numerous cities they passed so he could recover, but Diocletian ordered them to press on to Nicomedia. If he was going to die, he was going to die in the city that had been his home base all these years. The procession moved so slowly that it wasn't until the summer of 304 that they finally made it back to his capital. Upon arrival, Diocletian mustered enough energy to dedicate a new circus that had been built in honor of his 20th anniversary, and then he promptly disappeared into the imperial palace. While it's true that access to the emperor had always been carefully controlled, for the next 9 months or so, this control was taken to extreme lengths, and almost no one saw Diocletian in person. He was kept sequestered in his private quarters, suffering from an illness that kept him debilitated while refusing to kill him. On multiple occasions during these nervous months, though, rumors swirled furiously that the emperor had died, was about to die, had died weeks ago, or had been dead the whole time. At one point, he apparently slipped into a coma, which sparked rumors even within the imperial household that Diocletian was now, finally, dead. Galerius was alternatively called for or waved off with each cycle of rumor. When he was finally officially summoned in March 305, though, it was not to oversee funeral arrangements, but rather to congratulate Diocletian on his recovery. The emperor, though pale and gaunt, was not dead yet. Galerius, who was probably more than ready for Diocletian to die at this point, no doubt issued his congratulation through clenched teeth, but if he was disappointed that his time had not yet come, Diocletian immediately put his junior emperor's mind at ease. He was alive, yes, but Galerius's time was still at hand. Diocletian told his Caesar that he was going to abdicate the throne. As with the decision to elevate Galerius and Constantius in the first place, it is difficult to determine when exactly Diocletian decided that he was going to retire and let them take over. Some believe it was his plan all along, and that abdication was at the very heart of what he hoped would be a perpetually stable succession process. Others believe the idea only popped up later as Diocletian grew older and began to think about how he could best ensure a peaceful transition of power, and still others believe that it was never the plan, but that an overbearing Galerius essentially forced Diocletian to step aside. However long he had been planning eventual abdication, though, the long illness he just endured was the likely catalyst for setting his last plan in motion. Though it is worth noting that the date of abdication was almost 20 years to the day after the Battle of the Margus, so it is entirely possible that the illness was just a coincidental stop on the road to cementing a precedent of 20-year-long reigns for all future emperors. The trick was getting Maximian to go along with the plan. In order to ensure that the balance of power remained intact as authority was handed from one generation to the next, both of the Caesars needed to become Augusti at the same time, and the two new Caesars needed to be appointed at the same time, which meant that the old Augusti, Diocletian and Maximian, needed to abdicate at the same time. And as we will see, Maximian was not nearly as keen to give up on power as Diocletian was. The thing that has always stuck in my craw about the alleged necessity of everyone shifting places at the same time, though, is that when we look back on it, the only version of the Tetrarchy that ever worked was the one in which there was very clearly a senior Augustus who outranked the others. For all the outward professions of equality, Diocletian had always been the head cheese, and when we analyze the stability of the Tetrarchic system, it is hard not to come to the conclusion that it was Diocletian's extra level of influence over his colleagues more than anything else that kept them working as partners rather than rivals. Is it possible that things would not have gone so horribly awry if only Diocletian abdicated while Maximian remained in place, leaving a clearly senior Augustus around to keep everyone toeing the line? It is a question with so many moving parts that it's hard to figure what the end result would have been. But since things so quickly went to hell in a handbasket anyway, it is worth ruminating on. The answer, of course, is that it probably would have been even more disastrous for the empire. Not because the system didn't need a senior Augustus to function properly, it probably did, but because the new senior Augustus would have been Maximian. And I can't imagine a single scenario where Maximian handles his colleagues with anything resembling the deftness that Diocletian had. Civil war probably would have broken out the first time any one of them disagreed about anything. Because Maximian did not massage egos, he punched them in the face. His temperament was not at all suited for the job, which Diocletian thoroughly understood and was as likely a reason for simultaneous abdication as any abstract notions of equality of rank among the future emperors. Plus, and this is the last thing I'll say about it, following the untimely death of Constantius, the Tetrarchy will revert back to a model where one Augustus, Galerius, was clearly senior to his colleagues, and the system went ahead and collapsed anyway. So, it is then really hard not to come to the conclusion that the Tetrarchy didn't just need a senior Augustus. It needed Diocletian. He was the quintessential element, the ether within which the Tetrarchy swam, and when he was gone, there was nothing for it to do but die. So, getting back to the matter at hand, the trick was getting Maximian on board, and we have to believe that this was a project Diocletian had been working on for a while, planting little seeds in Maximian's head, so that when the day finally came to give up power, it would not come completely out of left field. You want me to do what? Give up absolute power? Have you gone stark raving mad? That is a conversation you really need to lay some groundwork for. So if you believe that he had in fact been planning abdication for a while, We can point to the joint trip to Rome as the time Diocletian probably began to really press the issue hard with Maximian, switching from, you know, someday we're going to have to jointly abdicate for the good of the empire, to please get your affairs in order because we're going to do this thing pretty soon. A short while later, when Diocletian was recovering from his illness, his tack switched again to pack your bags, we're stepping down on May the 1st. Given every single thing he did after resigning, though, it is clear that Maximian was not at all interested in abdication. But to his credit, his loyalty to Diocletian never wavered, and when the time came, he did what so few men in his place could have done, and what he himself so did not want to do. He gave up absolute power. On May the 1st, 305 AD, in simultaneous ceremonies in Nicomedia and Milan, Diocletian and Maximian became the first emperors in Roman history to voluntarily give up the throne. Diocletian, speaking to his soldiers, announced that he was tired, he was weak, and that the empire needed to always have a strong hand guiding the ship of state, and that he could no longer be that strong hand. That Galerius and Constantius would be the new strong hands was a foregone conclusion. So the only drama left to play out on that spring day was who would be the new Caesars. And it was in this drama that the Tetrarchy found the root of its eventual ruin. Once upon a time, I made the point that the five good emperors are often praised for having adopted qualified men of merit to be their heirs, rather than relying on their own blood sons, even though the whole reason they had to adopt outside their family in the first place was because between the lot of them, there was nary a blood son to be found. It was no enlightened decision they were making. It was something that was forced on them by circumstance. In attempting to secure the future of his tetrarchy, though, Diocletian very clearly stepped in the direction of that enlightened choice that had supposedly been made during the age of the Antonines. The emperors should be the best men in the empire, regardless of family relations. To cement what he hoped would be a binding precedent then, Diocletian intentionally skipped over the two men who at any other point in history would have so obviously been chosen the new Caesars that their ascension would have been as drama-free as the elevation of Galerius and Constantius to the rank of Augustus. Those two men were Maxentius, the son of Maximian, and Constantine, the son of Constantius. Instead, Diocletian went ahead and picked two established generals who were the sons of no one, Gaius Maximinus Dia and Flavius Severus. Now, the later Christian writer Lactantius describes a scene in which the troops in Nicomedia ripple with shock when they learn that the handsome, popular, and wonderful Constantine has been bypassed. But it is more likely that everyone knew what the score was going into the ceremony itself. Whatever their level of surprise was when they first heard the news, when Diocletian formally introduced the new Caesars, the choices were already known. So the probability that there were audible gasps and unhappy rabbling is low. That being said, there was definitely a faction within the army that was not at all happy Constantine, and to a lesser extent Maxentius, had been cast aside. The man who was probably least happy of all was Constantius, the new Augustus of the West. Sure, he had just been elevated to the highest rank in the empire, but oddly enough, the future did not look too bright for him. Because he was not just dealing with the fact that his son had not been named Caesar, but also with the fact that Maximinus and Severus had been. This gets into one of the other big mistakes Diocletian appears to have made before stepping down. Weakened physically and exhausted mentally, there is no doubt that by the end of his reign, Diocletian was allowing Galerius to take a lead on many imperial issues. We saw last week how this new dynamic likely led to the Great Persecution, as the fervently anti-Christian Galerius pushed for the persecution to be continually widened and deepened. We see it again now in the choice of Caesars, Maximinus, who would be Galerius's deputy in the East, was Galerius's nephew, and, I should mention, as staunchly anti-Christian as his uncle. And Severus was a friend of Galerius's, who had served alongside the new Augustus during his wars in Parthia. In other words, both of the new deputy emperors were Galerius's men through and through. Unfortunately, it seems that Diocletian simply did not take Constantius's feelings into account when he allowed Galerius to impose his own candidates on the Tetrarchy. And I don't mean that Constantius's feelings were hurt in a touchy-feely kind of way. I mean that the balance of power within the Tetrarchy was immediately thrown out of whack. The Augustus of the West was now isolated and without allies. This did not bode well for the future stability of the system. It might not have been a big deal had Constantius and Galerius gotten along, but unfortunately, it was the other thing. They did not like each other personally, and they did not get along professionally, which is no doubt why Galerius was keen to make sure he controlled both of the new Caesars. The issue of the Christian persecution amply demonstrates how opposite the two new brother Augusti were. On the one hand, you have Galerius, widely seen as the driving force behind the persecution, and certainly its most zealous advocate, and on the other you have Constantius, who did his level best to just ignore the whole thing as a disruptive exercise in pointless cruelty. With Diocletian and Maximian standing above them, the two Caesars could pull in these opposite directions and the center would hold. But now that Galerius and Constantius were the Augusti, well, pulling in opposite directions meant that the center would be ripped in half. Or, as Galerius no doubt hoped, ripped into his three quarters to Constantius's one quarter. In a number of fundamental ways, then, Diocletian's dream of a permanent tetrarchy was doomed the minute he abdicated. Not only was the new foursome of tetrarchs disunited, but there were two men standing outside the system, Constantine and Maxentius, who felt they had every right to be inside of it and were prepared to fight for their inheritance. On top of that, Maximian was still hanging around on the edges in his forced retirement, just itching to get back in the game. This was not a recipe for success, and on more than one occasion, the various players begged Diocletian, the indispensable man of his age, to come out of retirement. But once gone, Diocletian insisted that he was going to stay gone. They would have to work it out for themselves. Sadly for Diocletian, though, they did not. And even more sadly, he lived to see it all, as he did not have the good sense to die quickly after abdicating, like Sulla had done. Instead, Diocletian would live long enough to see the empire sucked back into exactly the kind of running civil war he thought he had put a stop to way back in 285. And by the very end, he would live long enough to see his own personal influence count for nothing, as he would be forced to use go-betweens in an attempt to secure the safety of his own wife and daughter, who were trapped in the court of the new Augustus Maximinus Dia, who appeared to have no interest at all in granting the requests of some irrelevant cabbage farmer. I want to close this week by making a brief and sad foray into current events. As you probably know, an earthquake ripped through Christchurch, New Zealand on February the 22nd, leaving the city devastated, many of its residents homeless, and basic services like water, power, and sewage severely disrupted. The History of Rome community includes listeners from all over the world, and I have gotten many an email with the .nz tag. In fact, one of the questions I answered during the 100th episode came from a Christchurch resident who recently got in touch with me to say that, number one, he is okay, and number two, that the city is in pretty bad shape. So attached to this week's post at thehistoryofrome.typepad.com is a link to the Red Cross New Zealand Earthquake Appeal site. If you were thinking about donating to the show in appreciation for my efforts this week, just go ahead and pass it on over to the Red Cross. Right now, I think the good people of Christchurch need it more than I do. Welcome to the History of Rome, episode 130, Lost in Transition. When Diocletian and Maximian stepped aside in 305 AD, there was a great deal of hope that their abdication would be merely the first in a long line of voluntary imperial retirements. Going forward, the dream was essentially for future tetrarchs to rule for 10 years as a Caesar, and then for another 10 years as an Augustus, before abdicating in favor of their junior colleagues, which would begin the whole cycle over again. The imperial regime would thus be perpetually renewed, perpetually refreshed, and perpetually free of dynastic struggles. The foundation for all of this had been dug and the concrete poured by Diocletian. The challenge now would be getting the cement to set. A challenge that would have to be met by the new set of four tetrarchs, Galerius, Constantius, Severus, and Maximinus Daya. That the tetrarchy would eventually fall apart is perhaps predictable. That it would begin to fall apart after less than a year, however, came as a bit of a surprise. As I mentioned last week, there was tension right from the beginning. Internally, because the two new Augusti were not exactly best friends, and externally, because Constantine and Maxentius had been left out in the cold. I'll leave the former issue for the moment, since the rivalry between Galerius and Constantius is about to become moot anyway, and instead focus on the two imperial sons who had been denied what they believed was their rightful inheritance, because their rivalry with the official Tetrarchy, and then their rivalry with one another, has a long way to go before Constantine will render all rivalries moot. Marcus Aurelius Valerius Maxentius was born in the late 270s AD and was the only son of Maximian, who at that time was still just a high-ranking general serving under the Emperor Probus. When Diocletian tapped Maximian to be his fellow Augustus in 285, the expectations for young Maxentius naturally skyrocketed. Diocletian had one daughter and no sons, and Maximian had two daughters and just the one son. The imperial daughters could and would be used to secure dynastic alliances, but Maxentius stood alone as the only blood son of an emperor. That he would become emperor himself one day was therefore practically a foregone conclusion. But as he grew up, Maxentius found himself not really being groomed for much of anything. He received a first-rate education and all that, but in his teenage years, just as previous heir presumptives had begun to receive the honors and assignments that had marked their path to power, Maxentius was instead granted no special favors and given no extraordinary commands. With the elevation of Galerius and Constantius in 293, Maxentius's future was clouded still further. There was no hope now that he would directly succeed his father, but that was okay. He was, after all, still young. If the Tetrarchy as established was going to continue, then eventually there would be new Caesars appointed when Galerius and Constantius were promoted to full Augusti. That, then, would be his moment to shine. His marriage to Galerius's daughter certainly fanned the flames of his ambition, as that was exactly how Galerius and Constantius had been brought into the family before they were formally invited to become Caesars. But in 305, now in his mid-20s and fully ready to fulfill his destiny, Maxentius was instead slapped in the face. He found out along with everyone else that he would not be named Caesar. Instead, two men from outside the family would be elevated in his place. Some say that Galerius did not like Maxentius, and so used his influence to deny him the prize. But others say that Diocletian was explicitly trying to break the cycle of blood inheritance, and so made it a point to ensure Maxentius and Constantine were kept out. Whatever the reasons, Maxentius went into a slow burn. His counterpart in all this, and soon to be arch-rival in all this, is a man who needs no introduction, which is why it is about time that we introduced him. Constantine the Great. Flavius Valerius Constantinus was born in the early 270s AD in Moesia, making him just about 5 years older than Maxentius. However, due to the career arcs of their respective fathers, Constantine's star would trail Maxentius's by a good 8 years. With his father constantly away fighting alongside first Aurelian, then Probus, then Diocletian, and then Maximian, Constantine never really developed much of a relationship with his father. Not that they were in any way antagonistic towards each other, just that, you know, they didn't really know each other. As a result, Constantine grew close to his mother Helena, a low-born woman who was either Constantius's wife or mistress, depending on who you talk to. The teenage Constantine was thus shocked when he was told one day that his father was marrying another woman, Theodora, the daughter of the Western Emperor Maximian. This turn of events was simultaneously a boon to Constantine and a potential death blow. On the one hand, his father was now the son-in-law of an emperor, and that has to be good news for your career. But on the other hand, any children born of Constantius's new marriage would almost certainly take precedence over the son he had already had with some peasant ex-wife years before. But whatever the new dynastic arrangement, Constantius never came close to disavowing Constantine, and quite the contrary, always declared him his rightful leading heir, doing everything he could to promote the boy's education and career. When Constantius became Caesar in 293, the now roughly 20-year-old Constantine was ordered to pack up his bags and head east, where he would join up with the court of Diocletian. For the remainder of the original Tetrarchy's run, Constantine would remain under the watchful eye of the senior Augustus, because, on the one hand, it was important for the son of a Caesar to be protected and to learn what imperial life was like, and so on and so on. But on the other hand, well, hostage is such an ugly word. In Nicomedia, Constantine happily entered the social and intellectual circles of the cosmopolitan city, and he furthered his education there, beginning to form the worldview that would come to change the whole world. Beyond his intellectual abilities, Constantine also showed himself to be a ready and able soldier. And in the late 290s, he served on campaigns along the Danube, in Syria, and finally, in Galerius's successful war with the Sassanids. By the end of Diocletian's run, it was crystal clear that Constantine was intelligent, personable, athletic, brave, and a natural leader of men, which is either something to be revered or something to be feared, depending on your point of view. There is no doubt that from Galerius's point of view, Constantine was something to be feared. And as with Maxentius, the incoming Augustus is often blamed for Constantine getting frozen out of the Tetrarchy. But again, it could have just as easily have been Diocletian wanting to table the idea of blood succession forever. But whatever Diocletian's wishes, it did not mean that anyone was going to take any of this lying down. The interests of the western half of the original Tetrarchy, for whatever reason, had just been blatantly ignored. If Diocletian and Galerius didn't think that was going to pose problems for them down the road, then they were in for a rude awakening. Initially, however, there was little the two snubbed princes could do. Constantine was particularly helpless, because the court that had been Diocletian's, the one he was presently attached to, was now controlled by Galerius, meaning that the new Augustus held the life of Constantine in his hands. Not only would this stifle whatever seditious ambitions Constantine might be dreaming up, but it would also serve as a convenient check on Constantius's activities. The new Augustus of the West fully understood this fact, and right away he began sending Galerius letters asking that Constantine be released, but Galerius ignored him. Constantine, meanwhile, petitioned the Eastern Augustus personally, asking, begging, demanding, imploring that he be allowed to go west and serve with his father. Legend has it that finally, in the midst of a drinking bout, a fed-up Galerius finally acquiesced and told Constantine he could go do whatever he wanted. Hardly pausing to pack, Constantine allegedly headed west that very night, crippling the horses at each post he passed along the way, convinced that as soon as Galerius sobered up, he would realize the mistake he had made and come after the fleeing Constantine. This exciting tale is probably hyperbole, but at its core lay the key truth that Constantine was allowed to leave and that Galerius had blundered in allowing him to leave. All in all, it probably wasn't so bad for Galerius that people thought he was drunk when he made the decision. Better that than for people to think that he had been sober. Whatever the real story, Constantine, now in his early 30s, arrived in Boulogne in the summer of 305, where his father was preparing for a return trip to Britain. Together for the first time, really, a father and son made their way across the English Channel and waged a brief campaign against the Picts, who lived north of Hadrian's Wall. The fighting went well enough for the Romans that in January of 306, Constantius again took the title Britannicus Maximus. But in the background of all this, his ascension to full Augustus, his reunion with his son, his war with the Picts, was the fact that Constantius was a very sick man. Probably the worst thing that could happen to the fragile Tetrarchy at that point was for an unpredictable illness or accident to take out one of the members before the new team could solidify. But unfortunately, that's exactly what happened. In July of 306, while working up plans for a second campaign against the Picts in York, Constantius suddenly died, leaving a big gaping hole where a solid leg of the Tetrarchic stool had once stood. The life and career of Constantius is often lost in the confusing shuffle of the Tetrarchy, and when it's not busy being lost, it's busy being overshadowed by the sheer giganticness of his son. But Constantius led a good and noble life, and it ought to be remembered. He brought Britain back into the empire, he kept the German tribes at bay, he ruled effectively over his territory, and though we don't have polls to confirm it, I would reckon that he was probably the most personally popular of all the Tetrarchs. It doesn't seem fair, then, that he is often listed as, quote, emperor, merely for the years 305 to 306. Making it look to a casual observer like he was just another transient and forgettable soldier emperor. I think we should give him full credit for his whole imperial career, and say that Constantius was about 56 years old when he died, and that he helped rule the empire, well and good, for just over 13 years. As is often the case, what happened in the aftermath of Constantius' death has been processed through enough propaganda and counter-propaganda that it's nearly impossible to separate truth from fiction. In the official version, that is, Constantine's version, one of his father's final acts was to recommend to the army that they proclaim Constantine Augustus when he was dead, and that when he died, that's exactly what they did. Other versions say that Constantius took no part in the decision to elevate Constantine, and that the army did it on its own, while still others state flatly that Constantine ambitiously engineered it all himself once his father was out of the way. So, again, it's hard to tell what the exact cause and effect was, but the end result was that the troops stationed in York, along with the King of the Alemanni and his men who were present, went ahead and proclaimed Constantine Augustus in July 306 AD. News spread quickly across the West, and in no time, Constantine's claim was recognized throughout Britain and Gaul. Now, I know what you're thinking, and yes, you heard that right. The troops went ahead and named him Augustus, not Caesar. So not only was Constantine being unilaterally inserted into the Imperial College, but he was being inserted at the top of the heap. This, as you can imagine, did not go over well with Galerius, his deputy Maximinus Dia, nor Severus, the man who was in line to actually become Augustus, should Constantius die. It also did not go over too well with Maxentius, who was suddenly in danger of being left behind completely in the now fast-paced world of the post-Diocletian Tetrarchy. Constantine sent a letter to Galerius informing the Augustus of the East what had happened, swearing that none of this had been his doing, that his troops had nearly forced him at spear point to become their leader, so what was he supposed to do? Galerius flew into a rage at this upstart's presumption, not believing for a second that Constantine was somehow an innocent third party in all this. but it was also an impotent rage. There was, maddeningly enough, little reason to doubt that the legions of the West, along with the allied German auxiliaries, were indeed loyal to the son of Constantius. Galerius could fume all he wanted, but he understood that at this point, only a full-scale civil war would be able to dislodge Constantine if the young pretender chose to fight for his claim, and that it would be a civil war whose outcome would not at all be certain. So after he calmed down, Galerius considered the realities of the situation and decided to bargain with Constantine instead of fighting with him. He sent back a message saying that Constantine's entrance into the Tetrarchy would be accepted, but that it would not be as an Augustus. Instead, Severus would properly receive the promotion that was coming to him, and Constantine would be ratified as the new Caesar of the West. Knowing that his position was strong, but not absolutely so, Constantine accepted the deal. He was playing a long game, and playing it for keeps. The first thing he needed was legitimacy, and that is exactly what Galerius was offering. Everything else would come in its own due time. Meanwhile, down in Rome, Maxentius stewed unhappily over this development. It was one thing for both he and Constantine to be left out of the Tetrarchy, but with Constantine now in, why was Maxentius still out? It was a question that began to be asked not just within Maxentius's inner circle, but also within the Senate of Rome. Though their reasons for talking about it were a bit different from Maxentius's. Maxentius was reeling from a personal slight. The Senate, on the other hand, was looking for someone to carry them back to relevance. This disgruntled prince in their midst seemed like the perfect guy. So they stoked his resentment and wondered along with him why noble Maxentius was being treated like a dog, why they were all now slaves to this Severus, who nobody knew and who nobody really liked. How much better would it be if noble Maxentius combined his power with that of mighty Rome itself? Together, they could seize what was rightfully theirs. By the autumn of 306, Rome was practically brimming over with revolutionary angst. And when Severus announced a new round of taxes, remember, that the Italians were not at all used to dealing with, the city exploded. Adding to this outrage, Severus also announced in October that the already much diminished Praetorian Guard was about to be officially abolished. At this, officers of the Guard went to Maxentius and hailed him as their emperor, asking him to put a stop to the rampant injustices of the tyrant Severus. Maxentius was more than ready to accept the offer. Working with the Roman nobility, he quickly secured the loyalty of southern Italy, Corsica, Sardinia, Sicily, and most of the West African provinces. But unlike his counterpart to the north, Maxentius did not presume to have himself proclaimed either Augustus or Caesar, and instead decided the least antagonistic course of action would be for him to wait for Galerius, now unequivocally the senior emperor, to recognize his claim to power. But whatever leaps of rationalization Galerius had been able to make when he recognized Constantine, he was unable to make for Maxentius. At least in Constantine's case, one of the four emperors had died, and a spot was vacant. But at present, there was no vacancy in the Tetrarchy, and so there was no room for Maxentius. Plus, Galerius had acquiesced to one pretender already. If he acquiesced to another, then every general in the empire would get it into its head that all you had to do was demand a promotion, and that pushover Galerius would then be happy to grant your request. So, no dice for Maxentius. Instead, Galerius ordered Severus to crush him. In early 307, Severus gathered up his army and marched on Rome, fully intending to return to Milan with the young man's head on a spike. But as it turned out, Maxentius was no pushover, and capturing Rome, no easy task. This was the first real test of the Aurelian walls, and they performed splendidly. Severus could make no headway, and the Romans were able to fend off his attacks with ease. On top of that, the troops Severus led had just spent the last 20-odd years serving Maximian, and their true loyalties were not hard to deduce, especially when they began to desert in droves to Maxentius's banner. It was at this point that Maximian, living a comfortable retirement down in southern Italy, could contain himself no longer. Envoys from the Senate, from the Praetorian Guard, and from his own son had already asked him to come out of retirement, but he had so far refused to break his oath to Diocletian that he was done with politics. But with Severus besieging Rome and his old troops defecting to Maxentius, Maximian could stay on the sidelines no longer. He left his villa and headed north. When word reached the capital that Maximian was on his way, Severus finally recognized that his position was hopeless. He withdrew with the troops he had left and made for Ravenna, where he planned to regroup. When Maximian entered Rome, he was happily embraced by his son and the aristocracy, who both saw the usefulness of having the ex-Augustus on their side. The old man's first task would be to lead the army north to capture Severus and force him to abdicate, which would open the necessary spot in the Tetrarchy for Galerius to go ahead and insert Maxentius. This, Maximian was able to pull off with ease. Severus really was an outsider in Italy. He had no friends and no stable base of power. When Maximian arrived in Ravenna, it was just a matter of time before the city was betrayed into his hands. So when Maximian got word to Severus that if the Western Augustus surrendered himself peacefully, that he would be allowed to live, Severus reluctantly turned himself over, seeing no other way out. His mission accomplished, however, Maximian revealed to the world that it was now dealing with a far less stable Maximian than it had grown accustomed to when Diocletian was around to moderate his vices. Once the Augustus was in hand, Maximian immediately broke the promise he had made and had Severus executed. We don't know exactly how old he was when he died, but Severus had reigned first as Caesar and then as Augustus for just about a year and a half. Now, whether it was the right thing to do is an open question. A good old-fashioned coup usually demands that the old ruler be ruthlessly exterminated, both to prevent him from coming back and to put everyone on notice that you mean business. But in this case, Severus was not the only ruler to be reckoned with, and killing him, especially after having used such a dirty trick to get him in hand, did not exactly make Galerius amenable to Maxentius's demands. Rather, when Galerius heard what had happened, he immediately mustered his own army and marched on Italy. There was going to be hell to pay for the murder of Severus. Facing a war with Galerius, a war that he had hoped to avoid, Maxentius quickly sent emissaries north to meet and haggle with Constantine. Maxentius hoped to bring him over to his side, but barring that, to at least secure Constantine's neutrality in the coming fight. Constantine, again playing the long game, did not jump at the chance to join with Galerius, and instead, his own offer was for neutrality and neutrality only. The price would be a marriage to Maximian's daughter and Maxentius's sister, Fausta. This would not only strengthen his overall claim to power, after all, he would now be directly tied to the Herculean dynasty, but it would also give him future leverage over Maxentius, should he ever need to leverage Maxentius in the future. The deal struck, Constantine was good to his word, and stayed on the sidelines when Galerius arrived in Italy in the summer of 307. The Eastern Augustus may have been mad as hell, and ready to blow Maximian and Maxentius off the face of the earth, but like Severus, he found this to be nearly impossible. Reinforced by all those troops that had been with Severus initially, Maxentius was now in an even stronger position than he had been before, and this time the whole of Italy was with him. As soon as he arrived on the peninsula, Galerius found nearly every city shut to him, munitions stockpiled behind walls, and hostile locals everywhere harassing his scouts and supply lines. Galerius pressed to within 60 miles of Rome, but was so frustrated in his advance that by the time he neared the city, he was more than ready to come to some sort of agreement with Maxentius, and he sent envoys to Rome to feel the young man out. But Maxentius was not as ready to deal as he had once been. He had bested one Augustus already, and it looked a lot like he was going to do it again. So why deal down? Had he not already proven himself to be the strongest of them all? The envoys were sent back with a no deal. Now, just spinning with rage, Galerius found himself in a position similar to Severus. Isolated in enemy territory, his own troops were getting itchy feet, enticed as they were by the lucrative promises Maxentius and his agents had been spreading among them. The Eastern Augustus decided that his only course of action would be a humiliating withdrawal from the peninsula, but he refused to leave empty-handed. His men were clamoring for something to match the rewards promised by Maxentius, and so Galerius, maybe just to spite the Italians, let his men off the leash. They ravaged the countryside, burning and pillaging their way north. It may have felt good, and it may have lined their pockets, but if there was one thing that was going to be true from here on out, it was that Galerius, the senior Augustus of the empire, was now a supremely hated man in Italy and in Rome. So that didn't take too long. Diocletian had retired in May of 305, and by the summer of 307, the Tetrarchy was in shambles. Two Augusti were dead, one at the hands of an ex-Augustus, no less. Constantine had snuck him through the back door, and Maxentius controlled Italy and Africa, even though he operated in no legitimate capacity. As Galerius sulked his way back to Nicomedia, he tried to figure out how it had all gone so wrong so fast. He thought he had stacked the deck to his advantage, but when the hand played out, he wound up losing half the empire. It just didn't make sense. The only man he could think of who might be able to make sense of it all, and who could maybe figure out a way to get things back on track, was Diocletian, who had so far refused any invitation to get involved. Next time, though, Galerius will finally succeed in convincing Diocletian to temporarily give up his cabbages. The old senior Augustus cannot have been happy with the way things had gone since he retired, and I guess he figured that the time had finally come for him to throw his weight behind some kind of settlement that would get the Tetrarchy working again. I say next time because, unfortunately, there will be no episode next week, but we will be back in 2 weeks to cover the Imperial Summit that will solve all the problems that had cropped up since Diocletian's abdication, and in so doing, create a whole bunch of new ones.